Very good morning, learners. I welcome you to this online class of Odisha State Open University. We have covered number of subjects, and today the topic of discussion is strategic models or strategic management models. Basically, those strategy models, they are used, they are employed by organizations to improve their performance, to improve their operations, to improve their productivity, which can lead to the profitability and accomplishment of their corporate goal. So without making any delay, let's go to our resource person, Dr. Anshuman Jena, who is an academic consultant with Odisha State Open University. He is a very brilliant management expert who is well conversant with all those strategy and the application of strategies. So now may I request Dr. Anshuman Jena to start his deliberation. Sir, over to you.
Thank you so much, Srimay sir. It has been a great experience for me to discuss various concepts related to strategic management with our learners. So far, we have discussed about the basic understanding of strategic management, core concepts, philosophy, vision, mission, goals, objectives, and the strategic management process. So we have covered block one in the previous session. In today's session, we are going to discuss about strategic management models, which include environmental scanning and analysis, SWOT analysis, Porter's five forces model, value chain analysis, McKinsey's 7S framework. So these models of strategic management, like Srimoy sir has rightly put forth, these help any industry, any business organization to not only anticipate what is coming in terms of opportunities and challenges, it also helps the companies to identify their own strengths, weaknesses, and competency in general. It also helps them to prepare for any future eventuality in the form of opportunity or threat. So it helps the organizations to gear up their internal capabilities, enhance their internal capabilities to match the opportunities, threats, or challenges. And we are going to do all these analysis with regard to various elements of the business environment. In previous session, we have discussed the components or elements of business organization with regard to various internal and external environment. So this is a simple diagram that we have already discussed. So without spending much time here, let us come to our core point of discussion today, that is environmental analysis. What is environmental analysis? It is a unified, comprehensive, and integrated plan that relates the strategic competitive advantage of a firm with regard to the business environment or with regard to various elements of the business environment. We know that any change in any of the components of the business environment, let us go back to that particular diagram. Yes. So here, any change in any of these elements of the business environment, whether it is internal, micro or macro environment, it will have impact on several of the or many of the corresponding elements of the environment, like a strike in the trade union, though it is related to internal environment, it is a controllable aspect, it is an internal aspect of any organization. But in case of a trade union strike, it will hamper not only the internal manufacturing production process or productivity or output of the company, rather it will have direct or indirect impact on the customers, on the suppliers, on the intermediaries, on the business partners, on the competitors. It might, if it intensifies and it becomes severe, it might affect the political factors or the politics of the state or the politics of the nation even. So each of these elements have the capability to influence directly or indirectly every other element in the business environment. That is the reason we need to have a very scientific analysis of all these elements and their corresponding impact on every other element or aspect of the business environment. So what is environmental scanning? It is a process or it is a technique of gathering, analyzing, synthesizing information for tactical or strategic purpose. This scanning or the accuracy of the scanning gives the crucial input, gives the intelligence for strategy formulation. We will discuss how exactly. These are the simple diagram how the firm's internal environment influences the external environment and the task environment, how these three are related. So scanning each of these elements and their corresponding impact gives us, as business organizations or as strategists, gives us the leverage to modify or to act or to formulate strategies so that we gain the competitive advantage, we maximize our profit, we maximize or optimize our gain. That is the sole purpose of environmental scanning and analysis. What are the other reasons for environmental scanning? To know our own position in the environment or maybe in the industry in which we are operating. To respond effectively to constant change. Like we have already discussed in the previous session, that these elements in the business environment, these are dynamic, these are subjected to change. Some elements are subjected to rapid change. They change very fast and they change continuously. To keep a tab on those changes and their corresponding impact becomes very, very crucial, not only for the survival, smooth functioning of the business organization, rather it also enables, if tackled successfully or if tackled strategically, it maximizes the gain for the organization or for the business entity. It also gives a comprehensive picture. Where do we stand exactly as an organization? What is our position with regard to the entire industry? Where do we fit in the entire picture? If we anticipate these changes, we will be well prepared for the opportunities and challenges. So there will be no surprises. Even if there will be surprises, those will be anticipated, calculated, or those will be pleasant surprises. No surprise will be damaging the reputation of the organization or hampering the growth of the organization or giving any kind of negative impact. So survival, long-term sustainability, growth, these are also the byproducts of successful environmental scanning and strategy formulation. So there could be various types of environmental scanning, but to scan the external environment, we often use the PESTEL analysis, which we have discussed. So here let us very quickly go through all these variables or elements under each category, under each broad element. So the first is socio-cultural variables. It includes the social aspects as well as the cultural aspects in which the business is being established or the business is operating. It includes beliefs, art, culture, custom, habits, morale, laws, ethics, lifestyle, career expectations, regional beliefs or faiths, life expectancies, role of women in the workforce, role of women in the society, whether the culture or the society is conducive or promoting business, what is the family orientation? What is the size distribution, age profile of the population? What is the literacy rates, educational standards, and most importantly, birth and death rates? So these social and cultural variables tell us or give us a picture of the society in which the business is operating. So, by understanding all these aspects, we can formulate strategies where we are not disrespecting the social norms, beliefs, customs. We are not violating any moral or social code of conduct. That is something which will take us closer to the society. This will create a greater acceptance of the company to the society at large if we can culturally associate with the society. But yes, there are certain limitations. If something is not scientific, if something is derogatory, if something is related to blind faith, then we should not, as business organizations, we should not get associated with those aspects. However, respecting the society, cultural norms, beliefs, takes us closer to the society, and this creates an open door where sharing of information, where sharing of resources between the business organization and the society happens. Then comes the technological variables. At this era, the role of technology has become very, very crucial. Technology plays a critical role in our personal life as well as in our professional life. So, an organization should also be up to date with the latest trends, latest inventions, latest advancements of the technology. And what kind of technological environment in which the business is operating, that is also very, very crucial. How much budget the state or the central government is spending on research and development or technological infrastructure? How much the industry spending on technological infrastructure or technological development? What kind of technology these bodies are investing in, whether it is focus on enhancing industrial productivity, individual productivity, whether it is aimed at enhancing or streamlining manufacturing technology or processes, whether it talks about efficiency of infrastructure, which are indirectly associated with technology, like roads, ports, hospitals, healthcare facilities, communication technologies or facilities. How good are we in protecting the trademark? How good are we in protecting or filing patents and protecting the intellectual property of the business organization? And how fast we can adopt these technologies which are upcoming? So these concerns the business organization as well as the individual. But yes, if the individual is not capable of adopting these technologies, there could be limited consequences. However, if a company fails to adopt technology, it will have tremendous consequences not only on the business, rather it will have significant impact on various stakeholders of the business. So that is why keeping tap on the technological changes is must for the business organizations. In fact, most of the companies, they are heavily relying on various types of technologies depending on their nature of business or depending on their internal processes and all. Then the next crucial aspect is economic variables. So this talks about the GDP trends, the GDP growth rate of a country. How well money is available for investment? What is the quality of employment or wage, price? What is the per capita income? What is the income distribution? What are the rules, regulations with regard to establishment of companies, with regard to various clearances for foreign exchange, for environmental clearances, pollution, competition? There could be various rules, regulations, like we have Companies Act. So these concerns, the basic or the elementary aspect of any business, because these economic variables, they talk about the supply of money, availability of capital for investment. They also talk about various crucial aspects related to the individuals, whether it is disposable income, whether it is the status of employment or unemployment, wage rates. These aspects are going to influence or affect the profitability of the company, the profitability of the organization. That is the reason understanding these enables the company or the organization to anticipate well in advance any change in these economic variables might create greater problems or greater challenges or greater opportunities. Like at present, we see the impact, the economic impact of the pandemic COVID-19. GDP trends across all the countries are falling. supply of money has reduced. Unemployment levels have increased substantially. Disposable income has reduced. Saving habits are nowhere as compared to, there is no comparison in terms of the saving pattern that was before the pandemic, the impact of the pandemic. Availability of funds or capital is also very, very limited at present. So these kind of changes in the economic variables, in the economic environment, they have greater and direct impact on the function of the business. We have seen many startups, they have closed down. We have seen many individuals registering for getting unemployment benefit in the United States. Then comes the political legal variables. So as we know, it is the state or the central government which is responsible to formulate and implement rules, regulations of various kinds. The nature or the vision or the philosophy of the political party in power substantially influences the kind of rules, regulations they frame or they enact. We also need to consider whether the country in which we are operating or in which we are going to operate is a democracy or it is a dictatorship or it is a communist country or does it belong to the capitalistic philosophy or socialistic philosophy. All these philosophies, political beliefs, political ideology, they formulate or they influence the kind of business friendliness, the kind of environment, the kind of legal framework the government is going to enact, whether it is the antitrust law, whether it is the competition law or restrictive trade agreements, environmental protection laws, corruption, road safety, transport. We have seen in India particularly the implementation of GST, goods and services tax, direct benefit transfer through Aadhaar card, and of course if it is a stable government, if the government is in majority, it has got substantial number of seats, it is not a coalition government or there is a strong coalition among the partners, then the government is stable. If there is a stable government in the state or in the country, we can assume strong or bold measures taken by the government because they have the numbers in favor of them. At present, we are witnessing some disturbances with China. We have seen the corresponding impact on the society. People are advocating to boycott China. The government is also, if not very vocally, but they have already internally, if we believe the newspaper reports, so the government, particularly the central government, they are internally trying to discourage investment or trade or commerce with Chinese entities, either through FDI, foreign direct investment, or through FII, foreign institutional investment. So they are trying to disengage, and it is based on national security. It is also based on the political belief and the political ideology. So, this particular government or the BJP government at center, they have initiated several reforms. Whether it is demonetization, whether it is implementation of GST, what is the recent reform in the road and transport laws, whether it is Atmanirbhar Bharat, whether it is Make in India, whether it is Beti Padhao, Beti Bachao. So all these initiatives from the government are broadly aimed at providing comfort or providing or encouraging businesses, startups, and in general, the community. So the political establishment, as they have the power to legislate, influence tremendously every other aspect of the business ecosystem or the environment. Then the demographic variables, whether it is so the like age, gender, educational qualification, income, geographic distribution, income disparity, growth of income. So all these things are are coming under demographic variables, and these demographic variables give us a clear picture which is related to economy, which is also related to the society. Then the natural environment. The natural environment includes the availability of resources in terms of minerals, in terms of oil, in terms of gas, in terms of energy or green energy, in terms of the level of population, what kind of legislation, what kind of rules, what kind of policies the state or the country has to protect its natural resources. We have seen the central government recently announced that they are going to open up mining for the commercial or for the private entities or private players. So what could be the possible objective behind opening up these mines or these natural resources to private entities? It is to encourage them to initiate their manufacturing process. It is with the objective to ensure continuous supply of raw materials to support, to sustain their manufacturing. Because these natural resources or these constitute the basic requirement for most of the manufacturing organizations. So availability of natural resources is one of the greatest reasons for establishment of business entities in a particular location. Now let us come to another popular tool for strategic analysis. It is called the SWOT analysis. SWOT analysis, the full form of SWOT analysis is S stand for strengths, W for weaknesses, O for opportunities, and T for threats. The strengths and the weaknesses, these are our internal capabilities. These are related to the internal or the controllable aspects of our business. Or it can also be from individual perspective, strengths and weaknesses, these are related to the internal capability of the individual. Then opportunities and threats, these are mostly related to the outside environment. These are not controllable. So what is SWOT analysis and why we need to do SWOT analysis? And under what situation we should go for a SWOT analysis? It is an important planning tool that helps an individual or an institution to identify in a systematic, organized or scientific way its internal strengths and weaknesses. So it is a kind of self-assessment where we are trying to identify our strengths or core competencies and our weaknesses so that we can align our strengths with the opportunities and we can minimize our weaknesses and the threats. So this is the gist of our discussion so far on SWOT analysis. Strengths, weaknesses, these are internal aspects. Opportunities and threats, these are external aspects. So we need to match our strengths with our opportunities so that we maximize our gain. We need to transform our weaknesses into our strengths, or we need to look for opportunities where we are transforming the threats into opportunities. So before we get into specifics of the SWOT analysis, let us try to discuss what can be considered as a strength, what can be considered as weakness, what can be considered as opportunity, and what can be considered as threat. So any situation, any characteristic which is giving us some kind of benefit, some kind of leverage, some kind of advantage over our competitors can be called as a strength. Anything which is limiting us, which is exposing us to loss, to negative consequences. And by anything, we mean internal capability or internal characteristic. So those can be called as weaknesses. So what can be considered as opportunity? Any situation where there is a possibility of gain. Similarly, any situation which has a possibility of loss can be called as a threat. So now let us discuss some sources of strengths. So strength, and of course, it varies from company to company, organization to organization. Even if we are trying to analyze the strength or weakness or opportunity or threat for the same company, but in different markets, in different economies, in different contexts, then these strengths, even if it is for the same company, will vary. If we are trying to figure out the strength, weakness, opportunity or threat for the same company over different time periods, that will also vary, that will also change. So like the business environment, strength, weaknesses, opportunities and threat, they also vary. They also change over time. They also change over different conditions, market conditions, economic conditions, different situations. So nothing can be permanently become our strength or weakness or opportunity or threat. Nothing is permanent. It is all dynamic. These are all subject to change. So there we need to remember anything that gives us some kind of advantage can be considered as strength. And we are talking about competitive advantage, of course. Whether it is a powerful strategy, whether it is a solid or strong financial position, whether it is a popular brand, goodwill or reputation in the market, whether it is the leadership position in terms of market share or revenue, whether it is the cost advantage, whether it is proper communication with the stakeholders, good communication with the customers, whether it is the power of innovation, proprietary technology, customer service, superior quality of the product or service, and of course, alliances, joint ventures, collaborations, partnerships. These are some examples of strengths. These are all related to internal capability. These are controllable elements. And if these are all on the higher side or on the positive side, the company can benefit a lot. And that is why, or that is the reason, to consider these as strengths. We will also discuss other examples of SWOT analysis and examples of strengths, weaknesses, opportunities, and threat. So what could be the possible weaknesses of an organization? No strategic vision, no direction, no action plan, obsolete technology, weak finances, balance sheet, debt, lack of quality standard, lack of internal symmetry or synergy, poor research and development, lack of operational coordination, poor marketing or communication strategies or techniques, narrow product line, obsolete technology. These could be some weaknesses for any company or organization. And these are all internal aspects. These are all controllable aspects. If we know what are our weaknesses, then certainly we can work upon these and we can change these weaknesses and we can transform these to our strengths. But it is easier said than done. What could be the potential opportunities for any company or any organization? It could be introduction of new products, entering into or expanding into new markets, engaging or serving new customer groups, vertical or horizontal integration, snatching away market share from the rivals, building a stronger brand, popular brand as compared to the competitors, using technology to streamlining the manufacturing or the service delivery process, getting rid of bottlenecks, enhancing productivity, and of course, coming up with new innovative products and communication technology strategies. What could be the potential threats? Threats could be entry of new players into the market. Changes in the demography, demand, in the taste preference. Changes in rules, regulations, which might not favor us as business organizations. Then availability of substitute products or services, limited growth opportunity, adverse political and economic conditions like we are facing at present. So these are the possible threats for any organization. And you see, these are mostly external and uncontrollable. These are beyond the control of any business organization. But yes, they can influence it, mostly indirectly, but controlling or moduling these to benefit them is going to be a real task for any strategist. Let us discuss some examples. So those situations are given a graphical representation here. What could be the possible strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats for a product? If a company has multiple products or services, so the strength, weaknesses, opportunities and threat with regard to each product, with regard to each brand, with regard to each product line can also be determined and utilized for strategy formulation. This is another example of strength, weakness, opportunity and threat analysis. These are some of the components or elements under each category, and many of these we have already discussed, so I'm not going to elaborate this any further. But if you have any questions, any doubts, you can always ask us, you can always contact us. Better examples, detailed descriptions are given in your study material. So please refer your study material. You will find clear understanding and clear description and elaboration of these concepts. So the summary of the strength, weakness, opportunity, threat or the SWOT analysis is, we need to build on our strength. We need to recognize our weaknesses so that we minimize them. We need to evaluate our opportunities and align our strengths or core competencies with those opportunities so that we can maximize our gain. And of course, we need to research on our threats so that we minimize the propensity to lose, or we minimize the damage. So this is the same thing that we have been discussing with regard to the relationship between strength, weakness, opportunity and threat. Now let us discuss one of the greatest, widely used and most popular strategic framework or analysis technique, that is Porter's Five Forces model. So this model was given by Michael Eugene Porter. He was born in 1947, and this is a very popular quote by him. An industry's profit potential is largely determined by the intensity of competitive rivalry within the industry. So in his book, How Competitive Forces Shape Strategy, he has for the first time proposed this framework known as the Porter's Five Forces model. This model helps us to understand and ascertain the industry attractiveness and profitability, so that before we invest in a particular industry, we know what kind of profit expectations we should have, what kind of or how attractive the industry is in terms of achieving our objective, and what is the competitive landscape of the industry. So if we know all these in advance, we can formulate clever or better strategies. So what is competition? When we say competition, what do we mean by that? Competition is a situation or is a setup, or it can be an activity or a condition where one individual or one party is striving to gain or win something by defeating or by establishing superiority over its rivals, or in general others who are also trying to achieve the same. These are some classic examples or some classic scenarios related to competition, whether it is the rivalry between Coca-Cola and Pepsi, whether it is any game, any sport where two teams or two individuals are competing, whether it is the battle or it is a war between the rulers, kings, and of course, if they are trying to achieve the same thing. Even if, so a classic or a very normal definition of competition is someone who is operating in the same industry or who is offering similar products or services or trying to satisfy the same customer needs. But competition can also happen over procurement of raw material, licensing. Competition can happen over protecting the intellectual property rights, the patents, the trademarks. So there could be various situations, scenarios where players from different industry can also compete with each other. It is not that only those who are operating in the same industry with similar products or services, they are going to compete. Yes, they are competitors. They are direct competitors. They compete head on, but there could be indirect competitors who belong to, or who might belong to, different industry, who might have different products or services. Like at present, the economy is witnessing capital crunch. So to secure capital, multiple companies representing various industries or belonging to various industries, they are trying to secure that fund, that investment. So there, they are also competing. Even if they belong to different industry, even if they belong, they have different products, services or offerings in general. To secure raw material, to acquire technology, to find a good, reliable, trustworthy and collaborator or partner is also something which various companies belonging to different industry, they look forward to. So there could be various situations which might result in direct or indirect competition. So one can easily say that Pepsi and Coca-Cola, they are the competitors. Yes, they are the competitors, but a roadside Nariyal Pani Wala or the person who is selling handmade soda or coconut water is also competing with Coca-Cola or Pepsi. Maybe it is of lesser resources, or it is less capable in terms of mobilizing resources or financial strength, but essentially all of these companies or individuals, they are trying to quench the thirst of the individual or the customer. So in terms of having or providing an alternative to quench the thirst, these three are competing. Right. So there could be various layers into competition. So based on different situation, based on different scenario, we need to look at that. Then this is the model, the popular Porter's five forces model. These are the five forces. First force is the bargaining power of the supplier. Second is the bargaining power of the buyers. Third is the existing rivalry among the players of different among different players in the same industry. Then threat of new entrants and threat of substitution. So these five forces enable us to understand the competitive landscape, industry attractiveness in terms of profitability and ease of operation. So let us discuss each of these forces one by one. So first, the bargaining power of the supplier. So we understand, I'm assuming that we understand what is the meaning of bargaining power and who are the suppliers. So I'm not getting into elaborating those concepts. So the bargaining power of suppliers is high when a small number of dominant and largely or highly concentrated suppliers exist. A few substitute raw materials or suppliers are available. And the switching cost of raw materials or the supplier is very high. So these three situations give the suppliers the upper hand. Then the bargaining power of the buyer. The bargaining power of the buyer is high when the customers are concentrated in large numbers and buy in volume or in bulk. The products being purchased are standardized or undifferentiated, so that switching these products, these companies, these brands become relatively easier and less costly for the buyers. And if the buyer is a significant contributor to the revenue of seller, then the buyer has the upper hand. Then rivalry among existing firms. So it talks about the intensity of competition that is existing in which we are operating or in which we intend to operate. So competition intensifies if there are large number of players which are serious, which are large enough to mobilize resources and in terms of their capability. Competition intensifies when the demand of the products for a particular industry declines or the growth slows down. If the industry has low entry barriers and high exit barriers, that also leads to intensive competition. Then the fourth force or the fourth aspect is threat of new entrants. The industry becomes less attractive if new players can enter easily and start their operation. It is possible through government policies, maybe lenient government policies, economies of scale, easy product differentiation, brand equity, access to distribution partners, distribution networks, territories, and customer loyalty. Then the last force is threat of substitution. Substitution in general possesses greater threat whether the buyers have the habit or the propensity to explore substitute paradox, if the price of the substitute is substantially lower, then people might switch, or at least the price sensitive customers switch to the substitute product or substitute company or a substitute brand or a rival company or brand. If the switching cost is low, then if it is easy to switch, if it is effortless to switch, then people consider switching as it is convenient, as it is easy. If there is very low product differentiation, so it leads to switch, or it encourages the switching behavior of the customers. If a large number of substitute products are available in the market, that also encourages substitution. Then we have discussed ease of substitution, or how convenient it is to switch a product or to switch a brand. So all these are threats for any industry, any company. And yes, if close substitutes are available, so it becomes a greater challenge or a greater threat for the company, for the organization. So these are some examples of various situations, various industries for which we can easily apply Porter's Five Forces model and ascertain the attractiveness and the competitive landscape of the industry. I have given all these Indian examples with regard to four industries, but Porter's Five Forces model can be applied to any industry in any country. So that makes this model widely popular and acceptable and extensively used in strategy formulation. So it is already time. I think we should stop here. Now I would like to request each one of you, if you have any questions, any doubts, then please ask us. Please write in the comment section, or you can simply unmute and ask your questions. I'll be happy. I know within the stipulated time, I have been relatively fast in explaining all these concepts. So if you have any doubts, please ask us. We will be happy to give you more examples. We'll be happy to clarify each of your doubts. Thank you for your patient hearing, and over to Srimoy sir. Thank you so much.
Indeed, the fantastic presentation by Dr. Jana. Really vividly explained the many aspects of strategy models. And he came up with very live and very recent examples, so very pertinent. I congratulate him for such a nice presentation. And what I feel that it is not too fast, but it really went in a very reasonable pace. McKinsey S framework that should be covered, but as time doesn't permit, it will be covered in any of the class in the future. So by thanking Dr. Anshuman Jena for a wonderful presentation, and at the same time I would like to thank our technical support, Mr. Debasis Barik. Thank you, Debasis. So with this, I would like to request Dr. Anshuman Jena to say a few words, concluding words, before we say good day.
Definitely. Thank you so much, sir, for being the moderator of this session. And I must thank Debasis Barik for his exceptional tech support so that we could manage this session smoothly. It has been a wonderful experience with Odisha State Open University and with all our learners. Thank you so much for the opportunity. Looking forward to interacting with all of you further. Thank you so much.
Have a good day.